I would like to thank you all for coming, and I'm delighted to be here speaking in front of such a distinguished audience, and I want to thank MENAS for inviting me and for giving this opportunity to speak about my project, my research. And what I will present today is part of my book project, as Leila said. My book project is on musical discourse and cultural identity among Ottoman Greeks. So before I begin my talk, I would like to say a few words about this photo. So this photo was taken in the Ottoman Empire in 1884 during a funeral procession on Frank Street in Izmir. As you may know, Izmir was a port city with an ethnically, linguistically, and religiously mixed society. And today's talk is exactly about that complexity of late Ottoman identities. So when we look at history writing on the late Ottoman Empire, we see the predominance of macro-level state-centered and elite-focused approaches, which generally deal with constitutional, legal, economic, and socio-political changes. But I'm looking at the convergences and conflicts in late Ottoman Empire, in late Ottoman identities, and I'm looking at those convergences and conflicts from below and from bottom up. In today's talk, I will offer a historiographical perspective from within the study of cultural practices and cultural choices. I'll be mostly talking about musical practices, and I'll try to tie all these to the political domain, the domain of political change. Well, to say that identities are vibrantly mixed or fluid in the Ottoman Empire may sound like a cliche, but I think it deserves some reflection. And speaking about music, inspiration didn't care much about boundaries. So today, thanks to various archives and private collections, we can have access to the writings and personal notes of several Ottoman church musicians of Greek Orthodox origins. These musicians who were active in early 20th century Istanbul composed in various genres like marches, encomia to the sultans and the Greek patriarch, and of course, love songs. So, this yellow page from the notes of cantor Vasilaki Kamarado, cantor, Greek church musician, Vasilaki Kamarado, it's rather interesting because if we look at it carefully, we may notice that the musician used two alphabets, Greek and Arabic alphabets, two languages, Greek and Turkish, and two different musical systems, Byzantine and Ottoman makam system. As we read the first line, we may also see that Kamarados was inspired for his song from a poem written by a Turkish poet, Nazım Bey of Florina. So he was inspired by a poet who was from Florina, which is a town in western Macedonia, in today's Greece. Well, the generalized observation that music communicates a sense of ethnic identity, both to the members of the community and to the outsiders, is certainly true. Yet if we take verbal discourse, the language and vocal music, as the basic element which transmits an ethnic identity, a sense of ethnic identity, then we would be disappointed with the fact that language was not a stable category for defining ethnicity regarding the many Ottoman peoples. Depending on geography, Ottoman Orthodox Christians were divided into three or four language groups, or educated Ottoman Jews in cities shifted between four languages on a daily basis. If we consider nonverbal idioms in music as cues for ethnic identity, our surprise and disappointment won't be less. In the Ottoman Empire, musical idioms, styles, and techniques cross linguistic, ethnic, and religious borders. Now I would like to play you three musical pieces which attest to the similarity of vocal styles and techniques across Jewish, Greek Orthodox, and secular song traditions. So the first piece that I'm going to play is a Hebrew hymn which is called Kiddush Shel Shavuot, which is sung on one of the Jewish pilgrim festivals, which is called Shavuot. The singer is Rabbi Isaac Al-Ghazi, this one that you see. born in Izmir, died in Uruguay. Uruguay received a big immigration of Jews, and Rabbi Isaac al-Ghazi was one of those. And in the second one, we'll hear the first cantor of the Ecumenical Orthodox Patriarchate, Yakovos Nafliotis, chanting a hymn to Mary. This person that you see over here, born on the island of Naxos, and he died in Athens in 1942. But after the foundation of the Turkish Republic, he was still singing at the Patriarchate of Constantinople, but he died in Athens. And in the third example that I'll play, we'll hear Hafız Sami. So as the title suggests, Hafız, the reciter of Quran by heart. He sings a gazelle, which is a rhythm-free genre, vocal genre. And all these songs were more or less recorded in the first and the second decade of the 20th century. So I'd like to play these small clips from those. I have to get this down. So the first one from Rabbi. Cut it for time concerns. And this is coming from the Ecumenical Patriarchate's first cantor. Sun. Thank you. early 20th century cosmopolitan musical practices and cultural debates on mixed identities have to be contextualized within the framework of late Ottoman political reform and the rise of nationalisms. In this talk, I will look at the formation and contestation of identities in late Ottoman society from various angles. First, I will discuss the project of forging an Ottoman nation in sight of the Tanzimat, that is the mid-19th century Ottoman reforms, and post-Tanzimat state subject and sultan subject relations. There I will try to unravel the conflicts and convergences in identities by focusing on political discourse and allegiance. Then I will look at aspects of late Ottoman identities by reflecting on 19th century Ottoman ethnic, religious, and linguistic diversity. I will explore the concept of cosmopolitanism and emphasize the local factors which shape this phenomenon, in addition to European impact or the colonial framework, which has been so far at the center of the conceptualizations of cosmopolitanism in late 19th century Eastern Mediterranean. I will introduce two modes of cosmopolitanism. First, the local and non-elite interpretation of cosmopolitanism. And the other, a high pan-Ottoman form of cosmopolitanism. And finally, I will reflect on converging and conflicting identities in the late Ottoman Empire through the prism of the debates over musical heritage among the Muslim, Turkish, and Greek Orthodox musicians that reveal varying positions and arguments embedded in the discourse of cultural nationalism. The Tanzimat statesman initiated the idea of a supranational patriotism, which came to be known as Ottomanism, or İttihad-ı Osmani, or İttihad-ı Anasır. According to Selçuk Somel's definition, Ottomanism was, in quote, the policy of the Sublime Porte to promote the notion of one Ottoman nation, consisting of individuals with equal rights, sharing the same mother country, and loyal to the state and the Sultan. Ottomanism has also been seen as an official ideology which failed to secure the loyalty of all the subjects of the Ottoman Empire, particularly the allegiance of its Christians. While some approaches stressed that the intention of the Ottoman ruling elite, especially after the Young Turk Revolution in 1908, was to Turkify the non-Turkish elements, others saw the failure of Ottomanism as the unintended consequence of autonomy bestowed to the religiously defined corporate structures, the millets, in the second half of the 19th century. Despite their respective values, both views suffer from a weakness, which is that they both imply a teleological narrative of late Ottoman history, which ultimately and inevitably unfolded into the creation of nation states. I think that the key approach here should be to consider how Ottomanism was perceived by Ottoman subjects at different levels of the society. For an Orthodox Christian state official or merchant, this new dogma of equality and brotherhood, situated in the spirit of the reforms, supposedly heralded the abolishment of arbitrary rule and thus the arrival of wealth and progress. Whereas, for the local power holders in the periphery or the peasants, the major processes of administrative and fiscal centralization equated Ottomanism with the increasingly strong grip of central power over their autonomy. Therefore, the multiple key dynamics of late Ottoman history cannot be reduced simply to a clash between the supranational ideology of Ottomanism and various nationalist or irredentist ideologies. In fact, in most cases, the centrifugal forces which demanded more autonomy were not acting in the name of, for instance, the Greek or Bulgarian or the Serbian nations, but rather certain segments of those Christian populations were struggling to preserve their own privileges. Tanzimat Ottomanism was based on reciprocity between the subject and the state, and the symbol of the Ottoman dynasty was crucial in building an identification with country and the people, which transcended the immediate corporate group. In the Tanzimat era, the Rum, that is the Greek Orthodox elite of Istanbul, developed a doctrine of Greek-Turkish coexistence. for which certain historians have used the term Helleno-Ottomanism. This political doctrine has been identified largely with a particular group that held positions of power within the Ottoman system, the Neo-Fanariotes. So Helleno-Ottomanism, as described by historian Sian Agnostopoulou, was an Ottoman patriotism which legitimized the Ottoman rule over a millet whose identity was formed around Greek culture, tradition, and education. This Greek Orthodox response to Tanzimat Ottomanism was marked by an extreme devotion to the person of the Sultan, and through him to the Ottoman state, of course. This specific political discourse, joined in by the members of the Orthodox millet who belonged to various strands of the educated society, envisioned an Ottoman Commonwealth and unified, and this Ottoman Commonwealth would be unified in material and spiritual progress. Not rarely, the Greek Orthodox high-ranking officials and intelligentsia displayed what we can identify as Ottoman patriotism and even communicated their devotion to the state and the Sultan in a language that interestingly drew on a kind of empathy with the dominant faith of the empire and the dynasty, which is Islam. Christine Filiu's research on Neo-Fanariotes has revealed that in 1851, the Greek Fanariot statesman Vogoridis bestowed a poem entitled "Let's Do Our Best and Go Forward," written in Turkish, to Sultan Abdülmecid, who attended his daughter's wedding. As Vogoridis said to the Sultan, he wrote the poem with the goal of blessed sympathy and integration of Muslim and Christian countrymen. He further declared to Sultan Abdülmecid that he took his inspiration for the poem from the hadith, the saying of Prophet Muhammad, "Hubbul vatan min al iman," translated as "love of the fatherland is a part of faith." In another example, the allusion to Islam is more subtle, yet more interestingly perhaps, the Greek Orthodox author identifies himself with Muslim East as opposed to Christian West, which he represents as the other. The prominent Istanbuliot poet Ilyas Tantalidis wrote a poem in Greek for Sultan Abdulaziz upon his return from his journey to Europe in the summer of 1867. This song of devotion to the Ottoman Sultan, which is written in Greek, composed in an Oriental mode, and written down in Byzantine notation, indicates perfectly the complexity and hybridity of identities in the late Ottoman Empire. What is further interesting in this poem is that the poet seeks to legitimate Ottoman dynasty and its rule against Christian European powers. So let's see the poem now. English and English version is my translation from the Greek one, so this is the original one. "So the foreign peoples and governments saw the star of hopes of the aged Orient. So the mighties, the mighty, the kings, the king, the Christian saw the leading sword of Osman." Here we have the text of another song composed by the same Greek cantor, Zografos, meant to be sung at the circumcision ceremony of the Ottoman princes, the sons of Abdulaziz. The text refers explicitly to Tanzimat reforms and order. The new reforms and progress are achievements which justify devotion to the Sultan. "You are a mine of munificence and kindness, O you exalted sovereign. For under your protection and favor, our time arranged neatly and is in order. In his imperial circumcision festival, now he exhibited a rather different order. Long live, O the Sultan of the lands and sea, the Sultan Abdulaziz." Similar references to prosperity and order, yet with local cultural differences in rhetoric and metaphors, were common in all ethnic linguistic fractions of the Orthodox millet. And it is plausible to think that examples can be found among Ottoman Armenians and Jews too. Returning to the Helleno-Ottoman discourse, I have to emphasize that Helleno-Ottomanism did not necessarily refer to supranational identification. On the contrary, it fostered a distinctive cultural identity whose maintenance depended on, for instance, a national education based on a predetermined curriculum. The program of education cultivated by Greek Orthodox urban groups promoted the heritage of ancient Greece as a significant component of their ethnic and cultural identity, which was blended with the Christian heritage through novel symbolic practices and discourses. The second reason why Helleno-Ottomanism was removed from referring to a supranational framework was because the clerical and lay power groups within the Orthodox Patriarchate were demanding to be recognized by Ottoman state authorities as a distinct community with its own privileges, undermining, hence, the rational of the secular ideology of Ottomanism. The idea of the preservation of the millet and its legitimation through dual allegiance, both to the Ottoman Sultan and the Greek Patriarch, Orthodox Patriarch, encapsulated in Helleno-Ottoman ideology, appeared in later years in the form of several political projects of Greek-Turkish rule. And this was not unique to Greek Orthodox. Research has shown that also Arab visionaries imagined a Turco-Arabian empire in later years. Interestingly, in both cases, Greek and Arabic, as the languages of the New Testament and the Quran, respectively, bestowed by God specifically on the Greeks and Arabs, imparted a significant potentiality to linguistic self-identification and fostered a powerful ethnic consciousness by conflating linguistic and ethnic identities. The late 19th century Islamic reformist thinker Muhammad Abduh's concern for the perpetuity and stability of the Islamic Ummah and his support for Abdulhamid II can be seen as similar to the Greek Orthodox Patriarch Joachim III's ecumenical imagination of the Christian Orthodox Commonwealth, which was to remain politically unified under the Ottoman Sultan. The parallels between Joachim's Orthodox Ummah and Hamidian pan-Islamism are extremely interesting, but I will not go into that here. So, the inherently secular ideology of Ottomanism, which the Tanzimat bureaucrats had stood for, came to coexist under the reign of Abdulhamid II with a form of Islamic Ottomanism. The Hamidian regime's mobilization of Islam and its domestic use of pan-Islamic ideology were directed mainly at curbing the nascent nationalist movements among Muslim Ottomans. Yet, Islamist politics during Abdulhamid's reign alienated Ottoman non-Muslims. Given the tense relationship between the Ottoman state and particular Christian communities, especially in the aftermath of the 1896 events in Istanbul, which resulted in the massacre of Armenians, and the 1897 Greek-Ottoman War, Islamic Ottomanism was an attempt to separate out the internal outsiders from the rest of the imperial population. After the restoration of the constitution in 1908, the relations between the Turkish Muslim ruling elite and the Greek Orthodox elite became even more complex as parliamentary representation allowed for new spaces of political action. The Greek Orthodox, who were already well organized in community structures, took advantage of these opportunities and became actively involved in the redistribution of power. As Michel Campos put it, ultimately irreconcilable imperial citizenship discourses shaped the political culture at the very end of the Ottoman Empire. Beyond unfulfilled political demands, one should also consider the fuzzy nature of the Ottoman nation, to which the ruling elite expected the empire's diverse people's adherence. Despite the genuine enthusiasm and the increased possibilities of participation in civic Ottomanism and the large civic engagement experienced in the public sphere, multiple allegiances of Ottoman subjects were kept under control by the infamous Hamidian press censorship, to which also the later CUP governments resorted. Thus, in the last decades of the empire, political participation, imperial belonging, and identities were constantly debated under the spotlight of a tense climate. During the long 19th century, multiple allegiances and identifications became even more complicated under increased contact with Europe at many levels. In the rest of the talk, I will reflect on the convergences and conflicts of late Ottoman identities as they were shaped and informed by European impact, intercommunal dialogue, and discourses of cultural nationalism. But I'll start doing this by first unpacking and discussing a term which became popular in recent historiography in referring to the ethnically, linguistically, and religiously mixed societies of 19th century Ottoman port cities. Used in a variety of academic disciplines, the term cosmopolitanism entered in the 1990s the vocabulary of the historians who strive to make sense of the multi-ethnic, multilinguistic, and multi-confessional societies of the Eastern Mediterranean cities such as Izmir, Salonika, Istanbul, Cairo, Alexandria, or Beirut, particularly in the period between 1880s to 1920s. Since then, heated discussions have turned around the term's meanings, usages, and limits. In the post-national revisionist history writing, its usefulness as an explanatory category has been highly debated, since within the current popular and semi-scholarly discourses, it came to signify a retrospective and nostalgic look to imperial past from the reality of today's nation-states. The term cosmopolitan means, as sociologist Sami Zubayda described, in quote, "not the fact of multicultural coexistence, but the development of ways of living and thinking, styles of life which are deracinated from communities and cultures of origins, from conventional living, from family and home-centeredness, and have developed into a culturally promiscuous life, drawing on diverse ideas, traditions, and innovations." If we stick to this definition, despite the diversity and plurality of last Ottoman decades, it is hard to find, except in some limited niches, a cultural synthesis which totally transcended the influence of religious and national communities or distinctly defined cultures on individuals living and thinking. Secondly, historians have rightly shown some caution about reserving the term cosmopolitanism for a specific 19th century urban phenomenon which developed in contact with Western patterns. Thus, they differentiated it from the implicit multi-ethnicity and multi-religiosity of Ottoman urbanity of the pre-19th century. Moreover, one of the social conditions for the emergence of this phenomenon was the new secular conception of the state implemented in the Tanzimat era, and concomitantly, the creation of institutions and milieus of communication outside communal and religious authority, such as secular schools, voluntary clubs, and societies. The centrality of Western or European impact as a condition for the social and cultural phenomenon of cosmopolitanism in the 19th century East Mediterranean port cities cannot be denied. European colonial encroachment was definitely a decisive agent in the emergence of cosmopolitan cities. And the most important factors were the legal privileges and economic opportunities granted to foreign nationals as an extension of the capitulations, the immigration of foreign capital, know-how, and manpower, and the establishment of European schools. Cosmopolitanism and colonialism are inherently intertwined. However, cosmopolitanism is neither reducible nor equivalent to colonialism. I think that equating cosmopolitanism to the effects of Western or European influence makes the term wrongly a euphemism for European colonialism. And relatedly, restricting the use of the term cosmopolitanism to lifestyles of the westernized, secular, local, and foreign bourgeoisies of the late 19th century port cities might occlude us from observing other forms of cosmopolitanisms and also the internal and indigenous social and cultural fermentations that did not necessarily derive from an increased Western impact at different levels of the society. First of all, the Eurocentric and elitist approach to the term cosmopolitanism fails to see what might be named as a grassroots or vernacular form of cosmopolitanism suggested by the popular culture of the time, like songs, popular forms of entertainment, vulgar speech, curses, and jokes. Here I'm building on Will Henley's work, Will Henley's interesting article on cosmopolitan cursing in late 19th century Alexandria. I would like to give two examples for the interpretation of cosmopolitanism from below. Almost everyone from the Balkans knows the melody whose Turkish lyric goes, "As I'm on my way to Skutari, the sky suddenly showers us with rain. Oh, my beloved scribe dressed up long in sleeves. Alas, he has a long skirt tainted with mud." According to one of the established explanations, the song became popular in Istanbul during the years of the Crimean War, when a new dress code was introduced by Sultan Abdülmecid, primarily for scribes, katips. In mockery of the scribes, who began to wear trousers upon the decree of the Sultan, an Istanbul rowdy wrote a song pointing to Üsküdar as the place of foreigners with trousers, as it were, where the British and French soldiers were accommodated in the barracks there. More interestingly, the lyrics were set to a tune borrowed from a march sung by the Scotch troops of the British Army, composed with inspirations of Oriental airs on their way to Istanbul. This particular case of non-elite, local creative synthesis in the form of a criticism by the popular classes against a European import novelty may perhaps be taken as an example for cosmopolitanism from below. Another example of vernacular cosmopolitan practice could be a popular song that appeared in the 1859 and 1888 editions of a contemporary song anthology. The songbook Kalifonos Sirin was published by the Greek Orthodox cantor Hagi Panayotis Georgiadis. Georgiadis classified the song with the epithet trilingual placing it under the category of Greek and European songs in his anthology. This is the name of the anthology. And the lyrics are really fun because, as you would see, Greek word, toujours French, mefats is possibly a wrong Ottoman word. I think it's wrong. It should be vefats. Then, j'espère. The Greek continues, très difficile in canım, even not Turkish, but I think it's Persian. So it's a very interesting hybrid example. And the meaning is also very funny, perhaps. So I'm crying all the time, you unfaithful. I hope I'll get tuberculosis, because it's very difficult, darling, to forget you. So. Ethnomusicologist Thomas Turino defined cosmopolitanism as a specific type of cultural formation and constitution of habitus that is both local and translocal at the same time. Supporting Turino's definition of cosmopolitanism, this song perfectly reveals a fusion of Western cultural and linguistic influence with local notions of love and suffering. Typically, the collage of words in French with the two local Greek and Turkish languages suggests what scholars have referred to as Levantine cosmopolitanism, characterized by the prominent resurgence of French influence in the Mediterranean basin from the mid-19th century onwards. By pointing To the vernacular and popular modes of cosmopolitanism, I have aimed at fortifying the concept and definition of cosmopolitanism. I would like to pursue this further from the other end. The colonial or quasi-colonial framework falls short of explaining adequately what I would denote as a high pan-Ottoman form of cosmopolitanism. Let's remember the Ottoman reforms, which opened new avenues of expression and visibility for the existing local diversity. The indigenous mode of cosmopolitanism, which I'll talk about, was facilitated, admittedly, by external factors such as Western pressure on the Ottoman government towards providing equal rights to the Christians of the empire. Yet it thrived, though to a certain extent, because it fitted well the Ottoman bureaucrats' project of bringing Ottomans together around common political goals and prospects of future and a shared historical narrative and culture. No doubt, in this process, invented traditions like symbols and hymns were widely employed. The creation of a civic Ottoman identity depended on a favorable political ideological ground that allowed for the fermentation of approaches from diverse thought traditions and which concomitantly approved of and encouraged cosmopolitan patterns of sociability and lifestyle. Despite the disclaimer that cosmopolitanism may coexist with parochial identities, it is plausible to argue for an inherent link between cosmopolitan everyday practice and cosmopolitist perceptions of the self. During the Tanzimat period, the Ottoman ruling elite engaged in efforts of exploring the non-Islamic historical legacies of the empire, and furthermore, attempted to forge a new identity, as it were, for the empire, which fed on the multi-ethnicity, particularly Arabic, Persian, and Byzantine roots of the Ottoman cultural tradition. Naturally, this attitude conformed to the Tanzimat's cultural and political inclusivism. Again, within this context, the appraisal of the Greco-Roman heritage of the empire, and particularly of Istanbul, had largely to do with claims to modernity and efforts to secure the Ottoman capital, a place of honor in the timeline of the Western historical narrative. It is also well known that the Tanzimat regime provided official backing for projects like the display and the restoration of the Byzantine remains in Istanbul. This, what I would call cosmopolitist reappraisal of the past, had no doubt repercussions in the cross-communal relations among the intellectual elites, fostered by an increased linguistic promiscuity. For example, a remarkably large number of Ottoman Muslim literati of the Tanzimat period knew some Greek in addition to other foreign languages. A good example was Ahmet Vefik Pasha, the statesman and initiator of the first Western-style theater plays. He was perfectly familiar with Greek and had an intimate knowledge of the Greek milieu of the Ottoman capital. In the larger Ottoman cultural sphere, music, more pronouncedly than any other medium, brought various segments of Ottoman society together. In the 19th century musical scene, the common musical language, that is, similarity in manner, sound, tonality, that we saw in the examples that we listened to, shared by Ottoman musicians of different linguistic and cultural backgrounds, brought forth what I would call a musical solidarity. Also, in the proliferating discussions over Eastern or Oriental music, the response to Western cultural dominance provoked a sort of solidarity that crossed ethnic, cultural, and linguistic borders of the communities. Ottoman musicians, public intellectuals, and professionals from different ethnic and religious backgrounds partook in debates over music and sought to reinvigorate the indigenous music, advocating the view that the music of the Orient was in a state of decline and decadence. The variants of this particular approach to historicity existed also elsewhere in many modern political, literary, and musical movements launched partly as a response to European interventionism. Notwithstanding this shared response to Western ways and patterns, music was a battlefield in which discourses on heritage and claims to cultural authenticity clashed with one another. At the larger world historical context, during the 19th century, music had timidly taken its place alongside the more tangible markers of the nation, of a distinct nationhood, such as language and history. Examples are abounding. Let's take from the European perspective, from the European context, Wagner and Verdi are the most recognizable two examples. So debates on music had long been going on among the Greek literati in the diaspora and the Kingdom of Greece. Orthodox liturgical music was in the center of those debates, which focused on the issue of its continuity from Greek classical heritage. In a similar fashion, at the end of the 19th century, the Turkish Muslim poets and literary men were discussing whether Arab and Persian elements of the learned Ottoman poetry disqualified it as a basis of cultural authenticity and Turkishness. In both literature and music, Turkish aimed at cutting back Arab and Persian elements as well as Western influences. It was in 1899 that a Turkish musician, Rauf Yektaş, published an article in the Turkish newspaper İkdam with the title Music in the Greek Orthodox Churches. 8 years prior to this, the prominent Turkish journalist Ahmet Mithat had called for the compilation of a comprehensive history of Ottoman music. Yektaş brought up the issue in his article and mentioned the Rum, that is Greek Orthodox musicians, who contributed to Ottoman music with their ecclesiastical and lay musical works. He cited the famous 18th century singers Zaharia and Andreas, who was a tambur player at the court of Süleyman the Magnificent. He even appealed to the Orthodox Patriarch and asked whether the Patriarchate of Constantinople could provide biographical information on the prominent Greek Orthodox musicians of previous centuries for the compilation of the history of Ottoman music. Rauf Yektaş's passion for the study of musical theory would make him one of the most prominent and recognized theoreticians of Oriental music in the decades to come. Yektaş himself was initiated to the Sufi order Mevlevism and was practicing Sufi music. In the 1900s, he became interested in learning the music of the Greek Orthodox Church. In 1905, he contacted Patriarch Joachim about his wish to be instructed in Greek Orthodox ecclesiastical music and was eventually appointed the first cantor of the Patriarchate, whose music we listen to, Yakobos Nafpliotis, as his teacher. In his article, Yektaş emphasized the connection between Musiki Osmani, Ottoman music, and the ecclesiastical music of the Ottoman Greeks, and furthermore claimed that they both emerged from the same source and were based on the same theory. He also suggested that the seeming distinction between them was minor, a mere difference of style. When this article was translated into Greek and published in the newspaper Ne Efimeris, the Greek musician and folk song collector that we're going to see, Yorgios Pakhtikos, sitting in the middle of women who are singing and is recording. This must be around İzmit. Yorgios Pakhtikos responded to this with an article in the Journal of the Patriarchate, which was entitled, his article, Musicology Among the Ottomans. Pakhtikos wrote that the knowledge of music was national and musicology was nothing but the real and historical knowledge of the music of a nation, which formed part of the latter's specific character. He disagreed with the view of Rauf Yektaş, claiming that the chants of the Greek Orthodox Church were not composed in the modes of Ottoman music. He wrote, the modes of our ecclesiastical music, if they are precisely examined, are found to be identical not only with those of Byzantine music, from which it directly descends, but also with those of ancient Greek music. Existing side by side with this position, which articulated a seamless continuity of authentic and pure tradition and excluded outright contact with the Ottoman milieu, there was another approach among Ottoman Greeks regarding the issue of musical heritage. By contrast, the second position regarded the reference to Ottoman music as legitimate, yet subject to the condition that the sources of the latter also went back to ancient Greek culture, which the Rum of Istanbul saw as the basis of their ethnic and cultural identity. In other words, the exchange between the two traditions was justified by tracing both to a common prototype. In 1900, Cantor Yakovos Nafpliotis gave a lecture at Ecclesiastical Music Society of Constantinople, where he introduced the unpublished treatise of the 18th century cantor, Panayotis Kalajoglu, entitled The Comparison of Arabo-Persian Music with Our Ecclesiastical Music. In the printed form of this lecture, Nafpliotis put a footnote to Kalajoglu's discussion of Ottoman rhythms. He wrote that the combined Ottoman rhythms contained smaller units which corresponded to ancient Greek meters. Thus, he claimed that the 4-4 Sofian rhythm and the 3-4 rhythm derived from Greek poetic meters, Paeona and Spondaic, subsequently stating that all other Ottoman rhythms derived from these basic rhythmic feet, he concluded that the Ottoman types were based on the rhythms of ancient Greeks. We have seen two different positions within the discourse of cultural nationalism. The first one was an exclusivist interpretation of cultural identity, the other one inclusivist, but subject to a condition. These examples confirm that the interpretation of the musical past was and have been a central issue in the creation of nationally distinct musical traditions and identities. So I would like to bring this talk to a conclusion by linking the late 19th and early 20th century interpretations of Ottoman multicultural heritage, as the last examples have shown, to the perceptions of imperial cosmopolitan heritage in later periods, and stretching the issue to today's debates. As the first point, it might be important to stress again the existence of varying positions and arguments within the discourse of cultural nationalism of the late 19th century. Until the Great War, Ottoman Greek urban middle classes did not consider political nationalism, and definitely not ethnic separatism, as an alternative to Ottoman citizenship or a Greek-Turkish symbiosis within an Eastern empire. Yet the turn of the century saw violent clashes in European territories of the empire due to the rise of ethnic nationalisms and the emergence of new alternative visions that challenged civic Ottomanism. Moreover, competition over new political spaces after the restoration of the constitution and economic rivalry, especially in the coastal areas, divided the society along ethnic religious lines. Later, during the Balkan Wars, the loss of territories with large non-Turkish populations and the sufferings of Muslims who fled to the empire signaled the end of the Ottomanist project. This coincided with the rise of Turkism and provoked discussions about the basis of loyalty in the empire. During the process, groups with ambiguous affiliations, such as Armenians, Greek Orthodox, and Dönmez, who are the Jewish converts to Islam, were excluded or expelled from the body of the nation. As Mark Bayer noted in the case of Dönmez of Salonika, but also valid for other non-Turkish groups, in the language and rhetoric of nationalists, these groups have been labeled as cosmopolitan, in the sense of being disengaged and inauthentic, and therefore detrimental to the development of the national culture and economy. In the first decades of the 20th century, cosmopolitan or multicultural heritages have been rejected by purist nationalist discourses. I would like to conclude this talk with an insight into the current public debates in Turkey on Ottoman multiculturalism. The recent nostalgia about the Ottoman mosaic displays a range of attitudes. I will mention only two. Fragments of educated middle and upper class residents of major cities in Turkey look back with a nostalgic appreciation to the legacy of the past conviviality of Muslims and non-Muslims in the last Ottoman decades. This attitude can be partly explained by the social tensions which emerged due to the massive rural migration in the 1950s and later. Migrants moved into the vacant places left by the expelled Greeks and Armenians. But secondly, this can also be explained by the upsurge of Islamism in the sense that these groups have largely seen the non-Islamic past of the country as an antidote to the rise of political Islam. The second position has Islamist nationalist overtones and overlaps with what recent scholarship has come to refer to as the phenomenon of neo-Ottomanism. It is the populist appraisal of Ottoman plurality embedded in an ethnocentric narrative that accommodates diversity only within the discourse of Ottoman tolerance towards non-Muslim minorities. Thank you very much.